wife in Havelock. I'm the Mississippi Madman Living Creed, and you are?
I'm David Vega.
Nice to meet you, brother. All right, well, this is Life in Havelock, just a little interview. Just try to help you out there a little more. Send it to you if you want to.
Perfect.
Cool. All right, first question is, have you always been a fan of professional wrestling?
For as long as I can remember. I kind of fell in and out as a kid. I remember the first time watching wrestling. I don't remember what pay-per-view it was. I just remember seeing a pay-per-view, and it was Hogan and Macho Man. I don't know if they were tagging, if they were wrestling each other. I just remember that, and then I fell out of it for a few years. And then when I got back into it, the match that pulled me back in was the Stone Cold Steve Austin versus Savio Vega, the strap match.
Oh,
yeah, that match, I saw that match, pulled me back in, and I've been a fan ever since.
Cool, that was a good match.
Yeah.
Well, who trained you, and where were you trained?
I was trained in St. Louis, Missouri, by a man named Dingo, at the Gateway Championship Wrestling Academy is what they had at the time, which turned into the Dynamo Pro Academy. But I was trained by him, and then I did a couple of stints over a course of 2 summers at the Jakarta Wrestle Factory.
When it comes to wrestling training, do you take to it like fish to water, or do you have a difficulty?
When I first came in, it's funny because I'm not afraid to admit this, I was a backyard wrestler, and I got trained later on. I came in with the knowledge of how to do things, because a buddy of mine went and got trained a couple years before I started. So he would teach us, just so our backyard wrestling would look better. So I knew how to bump. I knew how to whip and do, you know, stuff like that. The only thing that I really had to work on was my foot placements on certain things. But other than that, like, I took to it pretty quickly, you know, outside of, you know, high flying stuff. But other than that, I took to it pretty quickly, so.
Your wrestling name, is that your real name or something?
So my middle name is David, and then Vega is from the, he was my favorite street fighter as a kid, so.
Did you at one point have gear like?
Yeah.
I thought I saw you. Yeah.
Yeah, I still have the gear. I haven't worn it in a bit. I still have a bunch of the masks.
Did you have the claw?
I never had the claw, and the one reason that I didn't, because people kept asking me about it, if I've actually had offers for people to make me the claw. If I actually had the claw, I would have had to have used it on somebody.
That's true.
Where I draw the line. So.
I understand. You don't want to be New Jack.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, tell me about your first match. Who it was, about how many people, how many wins or draw?
My first match was against a buddy of mine in Tennessee. His wrestling name is Rigor Mortis. And he actually got me, but it was my first pro booking, and I actually went through my trainers because it was out of town, and I wanted to get their permission to see if they thought I was ready to have my first professional match. They're like, well, you'll be there with a buddy, it'll be fine, so yeah, go ahead. So I went, I was in Nashville, Tennessee, in front of probably 150 people, packed into like a little like bar type area. And then I lost, but I was super, super bad guy, super easy to be a bad guy. The funny part about it was my buddy was able to get me on the show because he knew the promoter, but apparently he was hard of hearing. So when he told him my name, completely botched my name and wrote, instead of Davey Vega, he wrote, if I remember correctly, Vady Voga on the flyer and on the sheet. So. That was kind of funny. I was like, what the hell, man? But it's kind of a funny story.
He could have been like one man gang, you know, he got to the original, they didn't have his name on the sheet.
Yeah.
And they're like, he looks like a one man gang. That's how he got his name. I was like, wow.
that I'm like, man, this match. Because like they always say, like, if you've had the perfect match, then you just need to quit. Because you've learned everything, you've done everything. Yeah. So like, I haven't had the perfect match, because I'd have to retire after that. But a lot of my matches that I've had against Kyle O'Reilly, dude is one of the best, if not the best in the world. And always, every time I wrestle him, I feel like he's able to help me elevate myself and elevate my game. So a lot of matches that I've had with him have been a couple of my favorites. I had a TLC match years ago with my trainer. That was one of my favorites, only because I got to tag with my trainer against a couple of my, I got to tag with my trainer and in a TLC match against two of my good friends, and we had a heck of a time. It was a good match. There was one match at Sableless Anarchy that I had last year against Jonathan Gresham that was by and far away probably my best match. That's just a couple of things in there.
That's cool. I appreciate it. Well, this goes away from the personal, but it's still personal. But do you watch TV wrestling?
TV?
Like TV wrestling, anything? Japanese, lucha, WWE, TNA?
Oh, yeah.
The question is, can you give me an opinion of it? Like, what do you think of it good and what do you think of it bad?
You know, if you would have asked me this, maybe 10 years ago, before like they started to hire all these indie wrestlers, I would have said that it's because WWE has always been about character and like character work and being able to talk and like being jacked and looking good, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. That was just the market that they were catering to at the time. Now the market that they're trying to cater to is a little bit of that. Because you still have your people like your Jinder Mahals and people like that are on the roster that aren't necessarily bad wrestlers. It's just they fill a role. But then they've hired all of these guys that busted their ass on the indies and worked their asses off to get to where they're at now. And they go out there and they know how to work. They know how to work a crowd because they've been doing it. They've been put through... the indies is basically your initiation into getting to the bigger stage.
They're the territories.
Exactly. Indies are the territories. If you would have asked me that 10 years ago, I would have said we need more people that know what the hell they're doing. Right. But now it's like, I mean, they don't do a whole lot wrong, in my opinion. Even like, I know a lot of people are pissed off at the, I don't bring it back up, the Jinder Mahal push. Like, I think it's great.
I'm really not.
Yeah, I think it's awesome.
He come back, he looks really good.
Yeah.
His work's improved.
Absolutely.
So I'm not mad at all.
No, absolutely. And then, like, for instance, like, people are so mad about this. It's like, no, this is awesome because it came out of nowhere.
You remember they did with Sheamus?
Yeah.
Like, a lot of people were mad about Sheamus. And I'm like, why are you mad? This guy looks good.
Right.
He's wrestling good.
Yeah.
It's not a negative. It's a positive.
And that's the thing. It's like, I think it's... at this point in time, people see somebody he looks good.
Yeah.
And then, you know, there was that that issue where he accidentally knocked Finn Balor out.
Yeah, he
I think maybe that had something to do with it. But I think they see a guy that looks good and they're like, oh man, WWE's falling back into the early 90s where it's Goo Goo Gaga, Lex Luger, Lex Express, stupid bullshit. But I don't see that. I think Jinder Mahal is... by and far away 10 times a better worker than Lex Luger as ever was. So, I don't know, like, I don't think they're really doing a lot of bad. Unfortunately, I don't get to watch a lot of it. I do check out NXT. I do watch more Japanese wrestling than anything. CMLL has always been a favorite. So, I like to change it up and watch a lot of it. I've looked at everything, but, I mean, we're... wrestling right now, so it has been for the last couple of years, and it's only getting stronger, it seems. So
definitely got a couple of options.
Absolutely.
Didn't have.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, what is your favorite kind of wrestling to watch?
You know, I love that mid-90s to late-90s, like All Japan, and then right into like the early 2000s, Noah, like King's Road type, like your Kenta Kobashi, your Kawada, your Masawa, all that stuff. I love stuff like that. I can watch that all day.
I tell these guys out here, when you watch Dr. Death versus Kenta Kobashi,
there's
no way you can't.
Right, exactly. It's like Stan Hansen versus those guys. Like
crazy stuff.
Stan Hansen, when they said, I don't know if it's true or not, but the Stan Hansen, when he knocked Kawada's teeth down his throat with the carrier. Yeah, exactly.
I can lose those.
Yeah, exactly. So. And maybe I'm just super partial to it because that's what I got. I watched it and I got into that more so than anything else, other than like, you know, because I watched it as a kid. But then I got into like ECW. That's another favorite. I still watch that stuff. Some of it doesn't hold up quite as well, but it's still pretty cool.
You mean old Taz match?
Oh yeah.
I love Taz.
Taz is my favorite.
I love Taz.
But that, you know, some of that Japanese wrestling, and like one of my favorite performers right now is Nakajima from Noah New Japan. Like I watch him constantly. So
I can see a lot of stuff on YouTube. So that's where I live on YouTube. Well, book me your dream opponent.
Man. It's kind of split down the middle only because, like, I watched this period and he was my favorite wrestler, but, like, Bret Hart, I love, and his prime to be able to wrestle him and pick his brain because he was the man. Technically, what, like, anything technical that I've ever done was because of him. But then also, Shawn Michaels, because he, in my opinion, besides Kenta Kobashi, best wrestler on the planet. In fact, I'd like to see Kenta Kobashi versus Shawn Michaels. If that ever happened anywhere, that would be amazing.
He might break Shawn's chest.
Exactly. But it would be so good. Like two of the best performers in the last 30 years, in my opinion.
Because I'm actually having Joe and ROH.
Oh yeah.
I watched that match
so good. Times. So good.
I love that match. Well, this is toward the end, but in the end of your wrestling career, what is your ultimate goal?
I think people are lying if they say that WWE isn't their ultimate goal. Everybody said that. And if they don't say it, they're lying, trust me. Like, that is would obviously be my ultimate goal. But if I don't ever get to that stage, my goal, personally for me, to feel that I'm successful, I would like to retire just knowing that people knew who I was, and then, you know, be able to wrestle over in Japan and maybe have a couple tours over in Japan. That's kind of my goals.
There was a question I didn't want to name this one. I've got something down personally. These questionnaires, I forgot. I wanted to ask you this question. I know you worked a little bit for Takara.
Mm-hmm.
How do you feel about intergender wrestling?
So I do it. For me personally, it's a little bit harder just because like things in my past life, and the way that I was brought up, it's weird. It's a weird mental disconnect for me. Hey, I have to go in this ring and perform and hit a woman. Now, obviously, there's the equal rights and stuff like that, but I have done the intergender wrestling, and it's always been with people I'm comfortable with, so that's who I'm cool with doing intergender with. I do think that some of the intergender stuff gets out of control, and a little too crazy.
Like the dude tells me from the buckle bomb, we're not even coming close to
it. Yeah, like, I think it's a real fine line because you'll have the people that are like fully against it, and then you have the people that are like, well, why are you against it? Because it's awesome. Like, I can see both sides, but for me, I'm fine with it. It's just I have to, if I'm going to wrestle somebody, I have to be comfortable with them. So.
Let me ask you this, all the fan base stars, do you think the fans believe?
The intergender?
Mm-hmm. Because I can watch it and I can see certain women against certain men, and I'm like, damn, that's pretty good.
Right.
And then I watch some and I'm like,
So, there, I think, like you were saying, there are certain things that are certain people that can wrestle each other, and you're like, okay, I can see this.
Yeah.
Ethan Page wrestled Allison Kay, and like, Allison Kay is not small by any means. Like, I mean, she's not huge, but like, you can see, you look at that matchup, and you're like, okay, yeah, I can see this. I can see this happening. Athena, who throws her weight around like a man, wrestles a bunch of these dudes, and like, she can hang with a bunch of these dudes. That makes sense. But like, I think there are times where it does get to a point where it's like, you have like a 5-foot-nothing girl, and a 6-foot-5, 250-pound guy, and it's like, this isn't so believable.
Yeah, it's hard.
Hard to pull that off. It's hard to pull that off with a man on man, like, you know, like, 6-foot-5 guy, 250-pound guy, beating up on a 5-foot-4, like that, and maybe it's like Rey Mysterio was the perfect guy to do it because he was able to make it believable.
One thing when I saw in TNA, and it was an Edge tag, and I can't remember who AJ's tag partner was, or Kong's partner was, but at one point in the ring, it was Kong and it was AJ.
Yeah.
And AJ's like, I can't get a woman. Yeah. She goes, don't be a fucking pussy. And he's like, all right. And he kicks the hell out of her. And she starts swinging on him. I'm like, you know what? This is believable.
And that's because Kong is a bigger lady. Like, she can make it believable. And really, you're gonna get people's opinions. They're all gonna be different.
I like asking the question because there's so many variations.
Right. And it's really like, there's really no, my answer is kind of in between, because like, if I'm comfortable with them, but there's really no in between on it. Like, it's either you hate it or you love it. So,
I always like asking that question there, just see what happens.
Yeah. Well, hopefully I don't get too much backlash for that, so.
Well, the final thing is just personal. It's like, wrestling's kind of a business where you get a little backstabbing, but you just pick up and stand by you through thick and thin. So if you'd like to say something to one and stick by you through thick and thin, or one to backstab you, there you go. So what you'd like.
I haven't had, I mean, there have been some political things and some stuff that have, over the 10 years that I've been wrestling, that have happened or occurred to myself or meeting people in my clique. It's all water under the bridge now. It's, you know, I just try to, I want to have a good time, and I want to have good matches, and I don't want to deal with any of that stuff. But to Albert, Fitchett, Pierre, Evan, and Gary, who all stuck by my side during the last 10 years and helped me grow as an individual and a wrestler, I thank you.
If anybody wants to get in touch with you or follow you fan-wise, how can you get in touch with you?
Email me at davyvega85@gmail.com. My Twitter handle is @davyvega85. My Instagram is @davyvega85. And then keyword on Facebook is just Davy Vega. I'm the only one on there. So.
Cool. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you.